All right, let's do our... This is from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. It's amazing that God is not silent, but gives to us his words, the exact words which we need. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us.
Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. Notice how verse 2, what does it begin with? And then verse 3. Uh-oh. Right. What are we to be looking at? Or should say, to whom should we look? And you know, that's the easiest answer, right? That's a kindergartner almost, or a kid in Sunday school. That's duh, right? But it's easy to say. But why don't we do it?
Sons and daughters of Adam.
Yeah. And it's interesting because the writer of Hebrews is clearly concerned about the people he's writing to, because there seems to be on the cusp of some of them, at least, kind of turning away and walking away. And throughout the whole book of Hebrews, he's constantly bringing before them the absolute beauty and magnificence of Jesus Christ. And as he's winding this, well, one person said, this is really not a book, it's a sermon. As he's winding down his sermon, he keeps coming back to it. Keep looking to Jesus. Consider him. And so this morning, and it should be our desire, our prayer every morning, at privately, personally, and as we meet here corporately, that we would see Christ, that we would keep our eyes, the eyes of our heart, fixed on Jesus, who here is beautifully described as the founder and the perfecter of our faith. And in verse 3, we are to consider him who endured such hostility against himself on our behalf. So let's pray that God would just grant through his Spirit a focused attention on Christ. Father, we are thankful for the day you've given us. Your grace and your mercy is renewed each day. And it's because of your steadfast love that we are not destroyed, that we do not perish. But the truth of the matter is, we are so easily distracted. We look to the right or to the left. We find the things in this world, fancies and excitements. And we do not look steadfast at Christ. I pray that this morning, in this service, and in the communion we have following, that our hearts would be locked on Christ. That we would look to Jesus, who has founded, authored, and is in the process of maturing our faith. That we would consider him who endured the cross on our behalf as the one and true center of everything in our life. Lord, as is your clear will, may the Spirit of Christ make much of Christ this morning. Bless and guide to that end. We do pray it in Christ's name. Amen. If you would, please stand for the reading of God's Word from Philippians chapter 3. Verses 12 through 14. I hope that we, every time we come, whether public or private, we come to the Word of God, we come with anticipation and a readiness to hear. For these are not the words of men, but the very breath of God for his people. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, and if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have obtained. And God's people said, amen. You may be seated, and again, let's look to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we now approach your word, and Lord, above all things, grant us a clarity of mind, a clarity of thought, a purity of heart, that we would, with both hands, so to speak, reach out and embrace your word for our lives. Lord, keep the devil at bay, for his purpose is to pluck away the word of God. Lord, I pray that you would plant it in our hearts so that it would grow to fruition. Would you pray this in Christ's name? Amen. If you look at this and you read it, one of the things you come away with is the realization that what Paul is doing here is he's talking about, from a biographical standpoint, the Christian life. And behind the text is the imagery of running. Foot racing was held in really high esteem and regard in the world of the New Testament. We actually today, every 4 years, we have a recapitulation in a sense of that very thing. I mean, every 4 years we have what? We have the Summer Olympics, and then we have the Winter Olympics. And where did that originate? Greece. Ancient Greece. And it was the competition, the racing, and that. And what you see here is this, in the back of Paul's mind, because of the language that he uses and some of the imagery and some of the words he utilizes, is designed for us to think of a race. Paul is picturing for us what it's like to run a race with a finish line not yet reached. We only have one runner here, and I kind of wonder and consider his sanity for doing it. But nonetheless, it is strenuous, isn't it? I was talking, we had an event at for school at Lincoln Park, and the guy I was with, one of the other teachers, he was talking about that he had run two marathons. And I thought in my mind, boy, you are stupid. I didn't say it. But you know, there are a number of people, like, for example, how many people are in the Boston Marathon or the Chicago Marathon? Mm-hmm. We're talking thousands and thousands of people.
20,000 in Indianapolis yesterday.
Was it a marathon?
A mini. Yeah, starting the 500 festivities.
But it was a mini marathon. There's 20,000 people. I don't know what a maxi marathon would be.
In different waves of people.
But clearly, there's something that we understand running, and maybe it is enjoyable to, at least if I was going to enjoy anything, I'll enjoy watching. but you know, we understand running, and that's the language here, because it's not something you do unless you're going to put yourself wholly into it, is it? But what Paul's saying here is he's picturing for us what the Christian life is. How do you run a race? And what is the focus in your mind when you are running a race? And what are you doing when you run a race? Now, he's doing this because this, as I said, this was language and imagery that they were fully aware of. This was, and God often does this. And this is the, you know, it's, you know, like a word picture. And this essentially is a word picture. So what Paul is going to do is kind of give us an idea that this is behind this is the imagery of a race. So the first thing that Paul tells us is that Paul was aiming after a goal which he had not yet reached. The picture that Paul wants to paint in our mind is a race. He's in the midst of the race. He hasn't crossed the finish line. In a sense, the finish line is a ways up. But how do you get the finish line? You have to keep going. I remember when I was in high school, I had a PE teacher. His name was Chopper. That was his nickname. We didn't say that to him. He was an ex-Marine drill sergeant. And he had no... he didn't care for us, I don't think. We were up in the track at Danville High School, which is a quarter mile. And I don't know who messed up, but we had to run Indians. And essentially what he did is, you're going to wait for my whistle. And so we started jogging. And an Indian is when he blew the whistle, the man in the back had to sprint all the way up to the front. And as soon as you were in the front, you blew the whistle. And then so on. And we did this a whole PE period. And it was a killer. I can still remember it this day. I thought I was not going to survive that. So when we think of running, we don't think of something that's easy or complex. And he made this statement. He says, if any of you start to walk, we'll do this the next day and the next day and the next day. So everybody, because you were supposed to jog, except the man in the back sprinted. But it was, you know, your sides were hurting. You were exhausted, but you pressed on. I don't think running is for the weak of heart. You know, when people who run professionally marathons, you know, running for time actually are doing their body damage, and it takes a long time to recuperate from it. So this is not something that is light. But Paul is saying he has a goal, but he has not reached that goal. In verse 12, he says, not that I've already obtained it, this, or am already perfect. I haven't arrived. I haven't crossed the finish line. I'm not there yet. In verse 13, he says the same thing. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. I am in the race. I'm running, but I haven't crossed the finish line. And in a sense, he's describing what Christianity, what the Christian life is. Now, what is this that he's looking for? What is this that he's seeking to obtain? What is the goal? What is the finish line? Excuse me. In the previous verses, Paul tells us what this goal is, what this thing that was his ambition, what was he after? And in chapter, verse 8, it says, the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. You know, the strange thing is that oftentimes you ask people what the Christian life consists of and what is a mature Christian, and they'll give, you know, like, here's a super saint. When do you think of a super saint? Well, they don't say bad things. That's good. They don't go to bad places. Yeah, that's right. They go out and serve. They do this. They do this. They do this. They're very active, very engaged. And I doubt you could find anybody that could keep up with the Apostle Paul, right? But yet, you think you can?
my picture is, as I see runners running down the track, there's two or three in the lead. And what I see is all three of them are stretching forward, just stretching their neck, trying to get that.
Yeah, and that's the actual.
Paul says, I'm not going to slack off.
That's the exact language. But the question is, what what is he running after? What is he running after? To know Christ, this surpassing worth of knowing Christ. There are people who would almost break their arm, patting themselves on the back for the things they've done or for the things they have refused to do. It is super saints, super apostles that Paul referred to in 1 Corinthians. It's I've done this, I do this, and so on and so forth. You have here what Paul is laying out is the ultimate pursuit of his heart, and that is knowing the surpassing worth of Christ. Nothing mattered more. He said it in verse 8, and now he's going to say it in two different ways. Paul restates this goal first in verse 12. He says, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own. And he adds this very important thing. He says, why? Why am I pressing on? Why am I going to finish the course? Because Christ has made me his own. I don't know if you remember, if you recall, what was the very last words of the last song? That's all right. That's why I picked it. The very last words of the last song.
He has made me his.
Go ahead and read the whole last line.
The whole last stanza or just the very last line?
Basically the last line.
He is mine, for he has made me his, or you want more than that?
Well, it doesn't. It has the word beloved before it.
Oh, yes, it does. There is no song that I will sing, no melody but this, that my beloved, he is mine, for he has made me his.
My beloved is mine. Why? Because he has made me his own. Now, just pause for a moment. what in the world is that saying? Here's Paul, and he's telling us and laying out for us what was the rationale for why he was doing what he was doing. Okay? And he says, what is the foundation and what is the root of everything that flows out of my life is this reality that Christ has made me his own. Okay? He possesses me. And at what price did Christ pay for us? Okay? Yeah. I mean, we are very familiar with what the New Testament says about the Christ, with the price that Christ paid. It says he when he was born, his name is going to be called Jesus, because he will save his people what? And the whole of his life was lived perfectly, and he was prepared as a spotless lamb before his shearers, and he went to the cross, and he did that in order to procure for himself a people. He didn't procure for himself just a bunch of employees. He didn't procure for himself a bunch of meaningless slaves, just chattel and worthlessness. He procured for himself, at unbelievable price, his bride. And Paul says, he made me, the likes of me, his own. I'm his. It's like in the Song of Solomon, I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. And is there any weakness or insufficiency or deficiency in Christ's affections for his people? Absolutely not. And Paul said, there's no fault in Christ toward me. But then he says, this is Christ's response. This is Christ. He would have me and he has me. What is my reaction to that response? And Paul says simply this, as he possessed me, he purchased me, I want to by faith possess him. We're going to close this morning. I belong to Jesus, now I belong to Jesus, and what's the rest of it? Okay, that's a song, old song we sung before, right? What does that mean to you? I belong to Jesus, yes. Now what Paul's saying, I belong to Jesus, now I want Jesus to belong to me. Now this is not some kind of weird possession that I've got a control of God, but this is the expression of the deepest relationship imaginable. And what Paul's saying here, that is what causes me to run. I haven't accomplished this. I'm not perfect. I have a long way to go, but I am running for this. I must know the one who possesses me. I must know Christ. I must know and experience the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. And so Paul ran. Now he says it a second way. He says it in verse 14. He says, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. The upward calling, and again, the picture here is the goal. That's like in a race. It's like the gold medal. You think about it. Here's these people, and they're running, and they're at the end they can stand on three platforms. They're the three out of all the rest, and they're going for a prize. And Paul says, my prize in this race is the upper calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now, the end of this race that Paul is thinking of is not here and now. It's there and then. That is so important for us to understand. I mean, we, especially in America and the West, are so comfortable and we're so at ease, right? There are things that are so minuscule, so trivial that we get all bent out of shape. And Paul says, my single-mindedness, if you will, is for that upward calling. Now, I think it's amazing because the Bible talks about an effectual call. God calls his people into himself. But this is a continuing call. It's a continuing call to come up, a continuing call to come home, where we belong. We are pilgrims and strangers in this world, the scriptures repeatedly tell us. The call to Christ in salvation is the call to Christ himself. I'll say this morning, we have our communion service, but so much we have to dismiss and eliminate the notion that somehow salvation is something. I will say this then, I'll say it now. Redemption is a person. Redemption is a person, and that person is Jesus Christ. Paul is after Christ. He's not after a process. He's not after a plan. He's not after a scheme. He's not after activities. He's not really ultimately after benefits. He is after the experience of eternally knowing God in Christ Jesus. And that, excuse me, he says is what drove him. What's the goal? What is the target that he's after? Now we find that with such a target, there is going to be pursuit. Paul pursues this gold and would not park. The measure of his effort was established by the magnitude of the goal. It's interesting, excuse me, in ancient Greece, when they ran, you know what they'd win? A laurel wreath, and then they would win free meals for the rest of their life. Okay? So they could go any place and they get free meals. Okay? And then they would get great honor. All of which, honor. Everybody, oh, he's throwing a race, right? I mean, it was, so, now you think about it. Is that a lot? I mean, in the big scheme of things? How much time does an Olympian practice? Yeah, a lifetime. I had a roommate, and he wasn't an Olympian, but he was a semi-professional roller skater. Now, it's kind of strange, isn't it? A semi-professional roller skater. I said, what's that? And they'd have competitions roller skating. Now, my roller skating, I can still remember, we would go, it was junior high, and we would go roller skating. And it was kind of like a, you know, a field trip or something. And I can remember the first and probably the last time I was in roller skates. I was coming, you know how you're supposed to go around? I had no idea how to go around. I was at a clip of speed, which I didn't want to go, but nonetheless, I couldn't stop myself. But there was a wall, and the wall stopped me. I hit it, fell down, crawled off, and said, I'm done with this. But he would practice 8 hours a day. 8 hours a day to become a professional roller, or a semi-professional roller skater. I thought to myself, you know, I thought, well, okay. Now, the strange thing is this. How is that? You know, you think about all the athletic endeavors. I mean, the people who win marathons, what do they win?
Sometimes nothing.
Really, in the big scheme of things, they win nothing. Okay? That's the weird thing. The weird thing is that we will put everything imaginable into perishable things. And we will not put what is imperishable. We won't put in. And the key is this, it is perceived value, not actual value. Now what Paul says, I know what is actually valuable. I know who is actually valuable. And that is the one I will pursue with all my energy. Now, you will pursue, and it's just part of nature. We will pursue, and we will put in the effort into what we perceive to be valuable, won't we? That's just who we are. If we find this to be so important, you know, it's like people that have hobbies, okay? And they really are in love with that hobby. What will they do? I mean, they no matter what, they will do anything and everything to expand that hobby, right? They perceive that to be infinitely valuable to them, when in reality, everything that we see is going to be burned up. You know, I was sitting there picking up this busted up mailbox. It was just crumbs and splinters. And I realized that is going to be the end of all material possessions. Nothing. Now, Paul, his perception was right because he realized that Christ was the true and only treasure. So, Paul said and realized that there was one thing that was of infinite value, because the truth of the matter is, all the, you know, free meals for the rest of your life. Ah, yeah, that sounds good, really? Yeah, okay, cool. You're going to die. True? You're going to be applauded by people. You're going to die. You will get a wreath of leaves. They're going to die and you're going to die. So what? Paul, by the grace of God, could see things more clearly. And he said, here is the infinite valuable reality in the universe, that I, a sinner, by the grace and power of God, might know experientially, forever, the beauty, the majesty, the wonder, the heart of God in Christ. So, you see what he does. You see, Paul describes how he pursues this goal. Three times, notice he says in verse 12, not that I have obtained, have already obtained this, or am already perfect, but I, what? Press on to make it my own, because Christ has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, and as Bob pointed out, when you're running, and especially here's the finish line, what do? They try to get out, right? And so if you're going to run, you know, it's interesting because you know what walking and running are in physics? It's control falling. It really is. Because you know what you're doing? I mean, you think about it. You are actually falling, but the whole idea is that the next foot keeps you from falling. So in a sense, it's control falling. And it's like, and you're running and, you know, you think when they, in the starting block, right? And then they fire the starting pistol and everybody takes off. It's just all this energy. All this velocity. Verse 14, I press on. Now, Paul used a word for press that actually was commonly used of people who persecuted other people. It was a very powerful, energetic, passionate word. If you're going to persecute somebody, you're going to do it because you have a bone to pick, right? I mean, and the idea is this was something intense. Paul wasn't just sitting there walking, you know. It's like, you know, can you imagine, here's this race, you know, what's the shortest sprint? Is it a 100-yard dash? Is that the shortest? Okay, the gunshot, you know, can you imagine guy just, I mean, would he not be the joke of everybody? But Paul says, I'm straining, I'm pressing on with passion. He says, with deliberation and determination. Notice he says this, I press on. He says, I strain forward. He says, I press on. Because if you're going to run a race, you have to be determined and deliberate in that race, right? And he says, and again, what defines and drives Paul is this goal, and that is knowing Christ. And when that goal was understood by Paul, when Paul saw by the eye of faith Christ, he was passionate to run, deliberate to run, with persistence. All the verbs and verbals are used here of Paul's pursuit were all present tense. This is something that he's continually going to do. He is not going to stop. He is not going to quit. He's going to persevere. It was with focus. I was listening to a guy preach, and when he was growing up, he loved to run. I guess there's a few strange people. But he never went a race because he was ADD or whatever. He was so easily distracted. He was far better than, far faster than everybody. But if you could look from a helicopter view, he would not run in a straight line. He'd run like this and like this and like this. And essentially, when a person would be running a 100-yard dash, his would be 120 yards. Well, what does that obviously do? So every race he was in, he never won. I mean, he was clearly, physically faster than everybody else. So he kind of got discouraged. Well, this one day, his dad said, listen, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to get at the finish line, and you just keep your eye on me. Dad, just keep your eye on me. And so, guess what he did? He won the race. It's like, it's joking. I mean, Dick Farm, how do you plow straight lines, straight furrows? Right? You got to pick a target, don't you? I try to do that when I mow, you know, I'm trying to get all the nice lines and stuff like that. But it's, right? Because I'm looking around. But the key is, but Paul says, my race is focused. And it leads me to the last point. It was single-minded. Notice what he says in the latter part of verse 13. One thing I do. He says it negatively, then he says it positively. First, I forget what lies behind. Paul's probably thinking of two things. One, he's thinking of, I'm no longer ever going to go back into that notion that I can win favor with God by what I externally do. I cannot gain favor by the works of the law. But also I think he's saying this, I'm not going to live on my laurels. I'm not going to say, boy, have I, look at my first missionary journey. Boy, wasn't it a success? Look at my second journey. Wasn't that a success? I think I've earned for myself a vacation. No, that's not what he said. I, forgetting what lies ahead. Forgetting it. But he says, one thing I do. He says, I'm going to forget that. And in its place, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be single-minded on the race. In Psalm 86:11, David says that he prays to God that God would unite his heart. What if we're praying to God to unite our hearts, what does that mean about our hearts? How easy is it to be divided, distracted? It is, isn't it? I don't know about you, but have you ever been distracted praying? I mean, doesn't it seem extremely strange how easily? I mean, what is probably, I can only confess myself, what is the least thing you like to do? Has that ever come up when you're praying, I got to go and do that? Isn't that weird? You know, the thing, I hate doing this, whatever it is, I hate doing it. And you begin to pray, and all of a sudden you go, I better go do that. Strange, aren't we? That's what Paul's saying. He's saying, he says, the one thing I do, I'm going to be single-minded. I'm going to be single-focused. I'm going to keep my heart focused on the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ. Paul goes on, and he says, he admonishes that this is in fact the course of all believers. He says in verse 15, let those of us who are mature think this way. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. The mature are those who are truly know that they have not arrived. That's the interesting thing. You know, there has always been in Christianity people who think they can arrive at sinless perfection. I remember I had a reading assignment was reading the commentary that John Wesley wrote on 1 John. In it, it talks about he argued for sinless perfection. And in it, essentially, they redefined a sin as a mistake. I don't sin, but I make mistakes. Now, there's a tendency for people to say, you know, well, I've done all this all my life. I have refrained. I've done this. I've done this. I've not done this, and so on and so forth. And there's almost this sense like, I'm finally pretty close to being done. You know? And what Paul's saying here, the people who are truly growing and pleasing God are those who are fully aware that they have not yet finished. There is still much to run. There is still a course ahead of them. There are still laps to go. And one of the scary things is it seems like after we get mature, we kind of mature in our Christianity, there's almost a sense, not conscious, but a sense like, all right, I've done my part. I put in my time. Now, I want to do what I want to do. Now, what that says is you perceive trivia and trash as the supreme value. And you will get that as your supreme reward. You pursue trash, get what you're going to get. Trash. You pursue worthlessness, and you will get worthlessness. Paul says, all saints of God who have been birthed of the Spirit have in their heart, in their spiritual DNA, a passion to pursue God, knowing that there will never in this life be an end to that pursuit. And it's wonderful. Always pursuing Christ, finding him ever to be true. Paul says, if anybody doesn't think this way, that's all right. God will make him know. And what he means by that, God is always going to correct his children to think correctly. We often start out wrong. Okay? And it's a good thing that he holds on to us. We don't hold on to him. And what Paul's saying is, you might not think this way. You might have a, but understand something. If Christ possesses you, he is going to have you. And he's going to make sure that you understand and comprehend this way. And part of the scriptures are written for us to understand this. This is, yeah, the Lord will make it clear to those who are truly his. It will make it clear. They will see this. Why? Because God will make them sure. What does God want? I mean, is it correct that God wants the best for us? Well, the best for us is him. And so God is going to work in our life whatever it takes for us to finally, for his people finally to come to the realization that he is altogether lovely. There is nothing or no one that even comes close. And that we will join with Paul in this mentality, this pursuit, like a runner running a race for a prize. This is the normal for every true Christian. This is for the normal for every believer, that we are, Christ has made us his own. Now we're going to pursue Christ as our own. One last point. Paul urges believers not to lose ground as they strive toward this goal. You see in the very last verse, only let us hold true to what we have we have attained. Okay, you're running, let's say, some kind of race that has 20 laps in it. I don't know if there's such a race. It's got 20 laps. Or I. You run 15 of those laps. Are you going to start going backwards? To win the race, you have to complete all the laps. And the 15 set the stage for the 16th, that sets the stage for the 17th, that sets the stage for the, and so on and so forth. There, the universal importance of building on previous progress. We have this, I just hate it, but we still, you can't teach an old, that is disgusting. In a Christian life, isn't it? I mean, one of the things that is so true of people who have been in the trenches, if you will, for a long time, is this is, you know, they say, this is the way it's done, and this is the way it's going to be done, right? You know, that's my mind. Well, what Paul is not talking about, that he's talking about there are truths that I have lived by and on that are the foundation and the predicate upon what else follows. You see a huge, beautiful tree that spring up overnight, and you realize that, let's say it's an oak tree. It came from an acorn, and as it was growing, just a little, just smaller than the end of your finger, like a pencil. But what happens over time? It keeps every year adding what? One ring after another ring. And those rings actually have two parts. They grow early and late. They keep growing. And so after 150 years or 200 years or whatever, you have this gargantuan tree. But this gargantuan tree and its growth and its success and its beauty and its strength was predicated on the fact that it grew step by step. One of the things that is scary is that now more and more in this deconstructionist idea is that as the culture's winds, the jet winds are coming our way. There are Christians who are saying, no, that's no, that's the way, that's not right. And essentially what they're abandoning is what was true and what they lived on. And Paul says, it's only let us hold true to what we have attained. You must hold true to it. There is, therefore, a real danger of losing spiritual ground. Otherwise, Paul wouldn't warn it. Here's a tree. Gets struck by lightning. You don't know it. But what it does, it cracks a hole in the bark. And then the insides rot out. As far as you're concerned, that tree is strong as ever. And then a heavy wind comes, it falls over, and then you see what? Dead on the inside. There are a lot of people like that spiritually. they look good on the outside, they perform, they do this, they do that, but in reality, the life, the substance that you know they started with is gone. And Paul says, no. If you're going to win the race, you got to build on the laps you've just previously run. Spiritual progress indeed is predicated on true past spiritual growth. Now I want to close with just simply a question. What do we pour ourselves into? What do we pour ourselves into? What do we exert energy? What are the things we think about? What are the affections that run, that rule the day? And you know, we can think, you know, we could list a whole bunch of things in our minds. And if we took the time, there's a whole bunch of things we would say, this is my day consists of this. There's things that are, you know, necessity, but you know, how much of the time in our life, here it is, all there. What is it that we pour ourselves into? What are we pursuing? As I said, whatever you perceive to be most valuable is what you will pursue with the most vim and vigor. I think there's an exception in the sense that we live in a day in which essentially the whole of culture is anesthetized. People have nothing. People are unmotivated. It's kind of like we live in a culture of zombies, brain dead, unmotivated people. And that's part of Satan's plan. But for the Christian, what do you pour your life into? What you perceive to be of the utmost importance. Now, what Paul knew to be the utmost importance is Jesus Christ. And so he ran. So he pressed on. So he strained forward, not for something, but for someone. And that essentially, honestly, and it's not a secret because a secret is something, it's writ large on Scripture. It's everywhere to be found. We read it this morning. Looking unto Jesus, right? Looking unto Jesus, consider him. We all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are being transformed from one degree of glory to another. It's laid out in Scripture for us. Clearly. Straightforwardly. The thing that we should set our eyes on, the person we should set our eyes on, is Christ. Once we realize the value of knowing Christ, that's what Paul's talking about, isn't it? Then what will we do with our lives? We'll press on, won't we? We'll strain forward. Here's the conviction for all of us. If we're not pressing hard to that end, if we're not straining forward, if we're not forgetting everything, if we're not letting our minds be distracted, if we are letting our minds be distracted, what are we essentially saying of the prize offered in Christ? Not valuable. You know, we can say whatever we want, but the truth of the matter is, what are we pouring into it? What we pour into it will tell us how much we value it. Are we pursuing Christ to make him our own? Are we looking at the goal of the prize of the upward calling in Christ Jesus as the ultimate and therefore all of my life and all of its facet will be to that end? It's an interesting question. I heard this some time ago. I was teaching. And when you teach kids, one of the most common things they'll say is something like this. What's wrong with it? You ever heard that before? You might have heard it from students. You might have heard it from your kids, right? They want to do something. And they say, what's wrong with it? Well, that's the wrong question. The question it should be asked is, how does it help me run? When the Greeks ran, they ran naked. And they ran naked for two reasons, but one of them, they were going to set aside every weight. can you run with a Walkman? There's no rule against it, or is there rules against it? But why wouldn't you?
Knowing things like that.
Right, right, but everything you add, what?
That much more you have to carry.
Right. Okay, so you say, well, I'm going to, You know, I want a snack now and then, so I'm going to have a cooler on my back. Right? And I love to drink iced tea, so I'm going to have, you know, a gallon on one hip and a gallon on the other hip, right? And I get so hot, so I'm going to build a fan that sits out here. Now, as far as I know, there's no rule against that. But does any of that help me run? That's the question we ask. Does what I'm watching and how long I'm watching, the hobbies I am involved in, the games I watch, what helping me in the pursuit of knowing Christ? Is it helping me? Is it aiding me? Is it assisting me? Or is it dragging me or hindering me from the upward call of God in Christ Jesus? This is, Paul says, this is it. This is it. And the scary thing is, what our life says isn't always what our mouth says. And so what we need to understand is to clearly, the admonitions of the scriptures we looked at in Hebrews 12, is to look to Christ. Once we see him as the infinite value he is, I'm going to say this later, he is truly altogether lovely. And once we see him as he is, then we will say, yes, press on, strain forward, press toward, forgetting, pressing on, because that is the infinite eternal value. And that's what Paul's telling us. He's saying, and not just this is his life story, this is the life story. This is to be the truth of all believers. And so we're going to sing, Now I Belong to Jesus. And I, you know, that's a wonderful words and stuff like that. I hope that that's more than simply words you sing, but your mind's eye essentially is imagining, here is Christ at the end of the race, and that's your running to gain him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we need your strength, your direction, because the truth of the matter is we are so easily distracted, so easily treasuring up for ourselves junk and worthless stuff and ignoring really you. I pray that your hand would be upon us so that we might be among those who are counted to mature. That is, we are truly pursuing Christ as our highest treasure. May the Spirit of God grant us the eyes to see this and hearts to embrace. I do pray this in Christ's name. Amen.